Alibi Jones and the Hornet's Nest, written by Mike Luoma, narrated by Mike Luoma.
Chapter 1. Deep Space. Reality rippled. The void blurred, refocused, and readjusted. An ebony shape materialized amidst the glowing crimson, black, and indigo clouds of a nebula. Out of nothing came a hulking alien leviathan, ancient in appearance. The huge interstellar traveler loomed over two small cargo vessels. Independent trader Hector Ruiz owned and captained the interstellar trading ship Libra Campista, had for over 10 years, plying trade lanes around and across the border of the Solar Alliance, near humankind's depot colony. His long-trusted associate Bob Bond ran his other ship, the Libra Campista de Dos. They'd bristle if you called them pirates. They didn't steal from others. But they didn't always operate within the law, either. Like most folks trying to make their living around the borders of the Solar Alliance, they got by. Surprised by their visitor's sudden appearance, Bond began running every scan available on the bridge of the Libra Campista de Dos. The new arrival could be a threat.
Then again, could be harmless. Hard to know, he said to himself.
The thing outside was mammoth and glistening black. It felt like a threat to Bond. Something about it rubbed him wrong. Felt like death. Bond called over to Hector's vessel as he surveyed the incoming data.
Holy. Hector, you seeing this? Bond asked. That's one giant dead old ship out there.
Seeing what, Bobby? Hector said.
Hector peered at the viewscreen in front of him on the bridge of the Libra Campista, trying to make out any details in the inky black surface of the new arrival.
Very funny, Hector.
Space junk, amigo, Hector said. Could be some serious salvage money.
That thing is huge, Bond said. I don't know, heck. There's something not right about it.
It's dead.
Inert. Muerto. Didn't know you were so superstitious, Bobby, Hector ribbed his friend. You sound like my mother.
Tell you what. You want it? You can have it. We're going back to Depot.
What?
Hector asked. He couldn't believe what he was hearing.
It looks wrong. Bond said. All wrong, Hector. I don't know how else to put it. I'm sorry, Hector. You want the salvage. It's all yours.
If I find something worth hauling off of there, you're coming back to help, you hear? Hector warned him.
Maybe, Bond said.
Hector watched as the Libra Campista de Dos turned and flew far enough off to safely make the shift into transpace. It disappeared.
You're a superstitious old woman, Bobby, Hector shouted at the comm.
Bond would hear the message once he crossed back out of transpace.
All right, let's see what's up, Hector said to his crew. Bring us in closer to that thing.
Alibi Jones let loose a bored sigh. He flipped through news feeds, looking for something to watch. The players in his aunt's room on Ceres Central had every possible human news source one could find. There was still nothing on. Alibi could hear his aunt in his mind.
There is no such thing as boredom, only boring people.
He didn't know who she was quoting, but he hated them all the same. He was bored, and it wasn't his fault.
Well, he said to himself, not entirely.
Although officially still a part of the Solar Alliance Interplanetary Force's Mediation Corps, Alibi hadn't been receiving new assignments. Not since he reported his involvement in the destruction of crime lord René Lavallure's city of Kismet to the safe brass. Though Alibi's connection to Kismet's ruination wasn't common or public knowledge, it was shared among his safe superiors on a need-to-know basis. Unfortunately, some of those in the Mediation Corps who supposedly needed to know felt compelled to act against his best interests. They didn't like him, for varying reasons, usually having something to do with the privileges they felt he enjoyed as a result of his ties to his aunt. A few of them, including his commander, Brandywine, seized on his reported accident as an excuse to keep Alibi idled, effectively sidelined.
watching the news instead of making it.
Boring.
Tired of news, he tried the history feeds and paused when he saw an image of his aunt as a younger woman. A network was running footage from almost 20 years ago, back when she'd been prime representative of the Solar Alliance. He turned up the sound. The image shifted to two men sitting in easy chairs. A somewhat rumpled-looking older man sat silent, while the neatly groomed young host introduced them.
Welcome back to Newsnight. We're speaking with Marco Valerius about his new book, On the World After the Eldred War, When We Were One. Thank you again for being here with us on Newsnight, Marco.
Thank you, John.
As I mentioned before the break, one of the ideas I find most fascinating in your book is the concept of the human diaspora, as you term it. You say it was both necessary and yet, paradoxically, detrimental to humankind, to the unity of the human race. Could you elaborate on that?
Certainly, John. When Anita Capituna was prime representative, it was really one of her cabinet representatives, Nico Constantine, who was the driving force behind the human diaspora, backed up completely, of course, by Prime Rep Capituna.
Of course.
The Solar Alliance government at the time believed that one of the keys to keeping something like the Eldred War from happening again was to encourage exploration and colonization. Spread the human race out across the stars so we weren't so concentrated in the solar system, so easy to wipe out and kill. Both Capituna and Constantine were originally from the Project, which made them interstellarists, firm believers in humankind's right to procreate and populate planet by planet by planet. After all, Constantine was the primary representative for Crankshaft, one of humanity's first colonies. And by the way, a direct economic beneficiary of the expansion plans of the human race.
Are you suggesting Constantine was economically motivated?
Aren't we all to some degree, John? That's a rhetorical question, don't worry. Actually, in my research, I found very little evidence that money was a motivator. It was certainly a happy side effect. No, Capituna and Constantine and that first cabinet were doing what they thought was best for humankind. Was a different time.
Indeed, it was when we were one. And we're talking with the author, Marco Valerius, here on Newsnight.
Nice segue.
Thank you, Marco. So, tell me, what was wrong with spreading the human race out into the stars?
There was nothing inherently wrong with it, John. It was just... Well, let me back up a little. At first, it was a very good thing. Although it was a little slow to start. Remember, humankind's numbers had dwindled, decimated by the Eldred Plague during the war. The early push for exploration and colonization was also a call to be fruitful and multiply, as it were. And in that, the program was wildly successful. Our population exploded, increased exponentially, giving us what we historians call a post-war baby boom. Our need shifted from humanity wanting to spread out to having to spread out. The SA government growing to view interstellar colonization as necessary, not only strategically, but also necessary to relieve overpopulation pressures after the war. Plus, humanity has always had a kind of conquering aspect. The SA government, in effect, launched humankind's manifest destiny out into the stars. Was the encouragement of the human diaspora wise? It seemed so at the time. Who could argue with the idea of saving humanity? But it ultimately fractured the unity of the human race, John. Look at us now.
I suppose.
What I chart in the book is that fracturing, caused by the human diaspora. Corporations, nationalities, families that had long been allies became estranged. Spreading out as we have, we've made that inevitable, haven't we? And it's only getting worse. In my new edition, there's an added chapter on the recent dissolution of the new Catholic Church.
But Marco... Humanity has rarely ever acted as one. It could be argued that during the Eldred War, we only became one due to the threat posed by the Eldred and their plague.
I don't deny that, John. It was certainly a factor. For a brief moment in time, humankind put aside its differences and actually came together. Afterwards? Without that threat? Sad. The bigger question for me is why? Why were we so quick to fall apart again? Was it because we had literally spread ourselves too thin? With humankind spreading out physically further and further apart? Even so...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.